Thank you, Mazyar, for this introduction. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to this e-learning session. My name is Chantal Frisse, and I work more than 20 years now at DNAVEA as an engineering consultant. And the last years, I did a big project together with the Ministry of Public Works, Rijkswaterstaat, here in the Netherlands, to automate the whole workflow of modeling, calculating, and analyzing bridges with Diana. And now I will give the e-learning session with the title, The Effects of the Traffic Loads and the Assessment of the Bridge Deck. And the last part I will do live with a live demo of a Diana model. The content of this session is as follows. I will start with explaining the traffic loads, what is written in the Eurocode and how we model it in Diana. Then I continue with the load combinations. And again, a Eurocode compared with Diana. And automatic load generations and combinations are defined in Diana. I will continue with the load factors. And furthermore, Diana improved and extended the design functionalities in Diana 10.4 version. And I will explain how you can shift the moments, how you can average the shear forces and moments, and how you can use the unity check to check your construction very easily. And finally, I will show a 3D model of a bridge deck applied with all loads, including traffic loads, and show the results of this design analysis in Diana. So first, I will start with explaining the traffic loads and what is given in the Eurocode. Here you see table 4.1 in the Eurocode, and that is given the number and sizes of the notational lanes. So the number of lanes are depending on the carriageway width. So if you know the carriageway width, with this table you can calculate the number of lanes. Then in table 4.2, it is given that you have to apply in load model 1. In lane number 1, you have a tandem system with an axle force of 300 kN and a UDL of 9 kN per square meters. In the second lane, you have an axle force of 200. And all the lanes further on, and even the remaining area, has a UDL of 2.5 kN. The third lane has the 100 kN axle force for the tandem system. And if you have even more lanes, there's no need to add an extra tandem system. Here you see the visualization of a tandem system. So one tandem system can be shown as four wheel prints, so two axle forces. And the distance in the width direction is 2 meters, and in the driving direction, in longitudinal direction, it's 1.2 meters. In paragraph 4.2.4 in the Eurocode, it is described that the location and the numbering of the lanes. And I will highlight the last sentence of point number 2. The location of the lanes and the numbering should be chosen that the effect from the load models are the most adverse ones. And even in the next paragraph in the Eurocode, it is specified that you have to apply the load models on each lane and on the remaining area in such length and width in order to obtain the most adverse effect. This is what's specified in the Eurocode. So what does it mean in practice? So you have to examine all possible locations and ordering of the lanes. So lane number 1, for example, can have the large, heaviest tandem system, and the second lane can have the tandem system with the 200 kN, and the third lane can have the 100 kN. But you also have them ordered in another way around. And to find the most worse at first effect, you also have to move the position of all the lanes completely to the left or completely to the right or in the middle to find the worst case scenario, the worst, the most adverse effects on the results in your bridge. So here you see, for example, if you have three lanes, this is the driving directions, that you have at least 12 possibilities of ordering and locations of the lanes. But this is just in driving direction. You also have to specify at which location should be the tandem system. So you really have to move your tandem system over the bridge and find in longitudinal direction the location of the tandem system to also attain the most adverse effects. So here you see again just one traffic set that the lane on the left side is having the very high tandem system force, the 300 kilonewton per axle force and the 9 kilonewton per square meter, square meters. The rest has a 2.5. And here you see tandem system 2 and tandem system 3. So to find the location of the tandem system in driving direction, which causes the most adverse effects, can be done with an influence line. An influence line represents the variation of a response, for example, a shear force or a moment, at a specific point in a member as a concentrated unit force moves over this member. So for an influence line, you have to select a result and a node. So here, for example, you see a very simple one span beam, and we are interested in the moments in the middle of the span, in the most negative bending moments, because it's a very simple example. We know that it will occur here in the middle. So that's why we choose this node. So we create an influence line for this moment in point number A. And therefore we move the unit load one part up, then we look what was the results of the moment in the node that we want to have and plot this on the location where the force is. And we do it again. So we move the force a little bit further. We look what is the results in the moment in the point A, and we move the results towards the location where the force is. So we do that continually when you're moving the force over your construction. So we even move it further and move it to that. So this is the method how to create your influence line. A little bit further. And of course, at the end, you don't have any moments anymore, because then the force is going directly into the supports. So finally, you get your influence line. And there where is the maximum, that is exactly the location where your force should be located. The disadvantage of an influence line is that you have the results just for one selected point. So you have to think on the forehand, what are the critical locations? Where does this extreme moment occur or shear forces? For some practical cases, it's not obvious to choose the most critical points. So that is why we in Diana use the method of the envelopes. All load cases can be calculated like we did with moving the forces around. And then we define the envelope. So the envelope around it to find everywhere, in this case, the minimum. So this is the envelope of all separate load cases. And then the benefit is, is that you have it in every location of your member, in every of your construction, you know what are the maximum, in this case, the minimum bending moments. So you see now that for in the middle, in point A, the load case belonging to the yellow one, so that was in the middle, was causing the minimum moment. But if you look into the location over here, then the blue one, so when the load was over here, was causing the minimum moment. So that is really the advantage of using an envelope. You know it for every node in your construction and not like an influence line only for one node. And another disadvantage of an influence line is that it's based on just one force. And a tandem system, like we saw in the Eurocode, are two axle forces with four wheel prints. So it's not that easy to get these results out of the influence lines. So how do we model these tandem systems in Diana? We define a mobile load with four wheel prints. Here you see the dialogue, what we have in Diana, and you have to say how many axle forces you have, what is the force of this axle force, what is the distance in axle in width, and what is the wheel print, and what is the distance between it in longitudinal direction, the direction of the loads, and you have to specify the step. So if you move this force, this tandem system over your construction, at which location you want to create automatically a load case. So automatically all these load cases are generated for every position of your tandem system. So in this case, every meter movement, the tandem system is creating a load case. And automatically, Diana will calculate envelopes of all these load positions of the tandem system for the maximum and minimum reinforcement forces, both in X and Y directions, and also the absolute maximum value for the shear forces in X and Y. And also, Diana will calculate what is the critical position for this tandem system to get these extreme results in reinforcement moments and shear forces. So the only thing that you have to define for this tandem system is a path, a line, where it moves over. That was all about the tandem system. The other part of the traffic load is the uniform distributed load, the UDL. In the Eurocode, it is given and written that the UDL should be applied only in the unfavorable parts of the inference surface, so longitudinal and transversal. So what does that mean? Here, I will show you a very simple example again. Now I have a four-span bridge, and we are interested in the bending moments in point A, the middle of the second span. And this is the result of this influence line. So what is the bending moments in this point A? An influence line is based on a unit load. A line load is equal to a point load on every location. So we integrate the inference line to get the contribution of the line load. So for a UDL, we have to integrate the inference of the surface. And like we saw in the previous slides, we have to take only the unfavorable parts of the influence surface as written in the Eurocode into account. So what does it mean? If you apply an only on the unfavorable parts, so here you see the force pen again, and here you see the influence line again, and we have to check if the unit loads on a location has a positive or a negative result to the moment in point A. If you want to have a positive moment, so you are interested in the maximum moment, you only have to apply the UDL where you have a positive result. So that means that you have to put a UDL only on span number one and span number three. Then you get your maximum moment in the middle of span number two. If you are interested in a minimum moment, so in the span, then you only need the location where it has a negative effect on the bending moments. So here and here. So that means that if you want to have a minimum moment at location A, you have to put the UDL on span number two and span number three. An influence line, as you can see, always crosses the zero axis at the locations of the supports. So the force goes directly into supports, and then you have zero results for the bending moments. So from this principle, we make use in the Diana approach. So in Diana, we create a UDL per span and even per lane if you have, because you have different values for your UDL per lane. For simplicity, I focus now only on the UDL per span. So in this case, we have four load cases, only UDL on span one, two, three, and four. Then in Diana, automatically the envelope is created and calculated between if the load is on and the load is off. So there's no load on it. So this is where there's no load on it, and this is the result when you have UDL of span one is loaded. So if you are interested in the maximum, he's creating a maximum envelope of the UDL. So you end up with this red line. But automatically also the minimum envelope is created of the UDL, and then you get this blue line. That's the minimum envelope. And then automatically in Diana, the summation will be calculated of all the envelopes per span. So the maximum moment in point number A is equal to the maximum envelope of the UDL in span one plus the maximum envelope of the UDL in two, three, and four. And the same holds for the minimum moment in point A is the minimum envelope of the UDL one plus two, three, and four. So in Diana, we check if the UDL per span has a positive or a negative result in the nodes. So if you are interested in the maximum moment, only the UDL per span that result in a positive bending moment are included. If you want a minimum moment, then only the UDL per span that results in a negative bending moment will include it. That's what we saw in the previous slide already. But this is exactly the same what we had with the influence lines. So you get exactly the same results. And I even want to show you it even more with this example. So here you see the bending moments, the results if you have UDL one applied, and this is then the bending moments along the members or your construction along the line for UDL one, on the only UDL1 is applied. Here is UDL2 applied. Here UDL3 and 4. So if we compare it with the previous influence line, and we were interested only in the moments of the middle of span number 2, so point number A, we have to see that was here, has this result of this load case a positive or a negative one? With UDL1, we had a positive one, and with UDL3 applied on the construction, also positive. So to get the extreme maximum moments in point A, we have to apply UDL only on span 1 and span 3. And if you want to have a negative one, you have to apply UDL 2 and 4. And this is exactly the same what we saw in the previous slides with the influence line. We can define the load cases of UDL in two ways. We have two methods for that. We can use the distributed force or the equilateral force. For the distributed force, you always have to select a face and use the distributed force, select a face, and you can enter your surface force value. So in this case, for example, in a lane, the 2.5 kilometers per square meters. The second option is also related to a face, and you have to choose the equilateral force option. Then the surface that you select over here can be defined independent on the construction and so on the mesh. So you don't need to imprint it on your construction. But the only disadvantage is that you now have to enter a force, a total force, and this force will be uniformly distributed over the area. So now we have defined the tandem system and the UDL in Diana. So the next step is to combine them into traffic sets. And these are one possible lane combination in ordering. So for example, lane number 1 has a tandem system with the axle force of 300 and a UDL of the 9. In lane number 2, the 200, and lane number 3, the 300. So this is just one traffic set. This one traffic set, but you have to define them all because there are more possibilities, like I showed you in the previous slides, in ordering the heaviest tandem system on other lanes as well. So how are we going to do that in Diana? We have to use the option in the design analysis by using add check on normative loading. Then automatically in the analysis tree, the check on normative loading is occurring in the tree. And if you then right click on it and edit properties, you can define your traffic sets. Then this dialog appears. And this dialogue has three tab forms, and the middle one is the traffic load sets. All the loads that you have labeled as not used in the loads, I will show you later on when I explain this tab, will be used in the traffic sets. You have to define your representativity factor. And this is given in tables in the Eurocode, but can vary for every annex. So it can be other values specified over there. So you have to add a new set. And for every set, you have to define which UDL is active and which tandem system is active. And if you have used a tandem system and mold as just 100 kilonewton, for example, then you can use the load factors to create the 300, the 200, and the 100 kilonewton. So in this case, the right 1, 2, 3 is exactly this situation that we have in lane number 1, the 300 kilonewtons in lane number 2, the 200 in lane number 3, the 100, and we have to add some extra heavy part to get the 9 kilonewton per square meters on the lane where is the heavy tandem system. You can just create one, and it is easy to add, copy the other one and change from not the heavy UDL in lane 1 but in lane 2, and change the load factors, and then already you have another traffic set. That was all about the UDL and the tandem system and the traffic sets. So the next step is that we continue with the load combinations. In the Eurocode, it is specified that all load combinations should be considered which result in a critical design condition at all sections. So what does it mean? What we do in Diana is that we automatically create all load combinations and envelopes. Then you know for every, because of the envelopes, you will calculate the maximum and minimum reinforcement forces and absolute maximum shear forces for the whole constructions. So what do we do in Diana? As I say, everything is going automatically. And here you see the whole workflow. So there are 5 steps. The user has to specify the separate load cases, but Diana will automatically calculate the load combinations. And then out of the load combination, he automatically creates the envelopes over the load combinations. For the traffic loads, he also has to define the traffic set, as I showed before, and you have to define the envelope over the set of traffic. This is done automatically. And then depending on which type you have, so you have a permanent load, a variable load, a unique load, but it's not in this graph, and a mobile load, a tandem system of a UDL system, you're following another path. So for the permanent load, it is given in the Eurocode that you have to specify and multiply it by an unfavorable and a favorable load factor. And then automatically in Diana, we create an envelope out of this multiplication factor with favorable and unfavorable. And at the end, they will automatically combine to get the final load of the permanent load, the envelope of the permanent load plus the variable of the envelope of the variable loads, and the envelope out of all the traffic set that you have defined as the final traffic load. So these load factors are depending on your load type. So here you see the first tab of the normative loading. And here you can see that you have a list of all the load cases that you have specified. And then you have to set yourself the load type. It can be permanent, variable dominant, variable secondary, or unique. If you keep it on not used, then automatically this list will be used in the traffic load sets that I showed you previously. So the last thing that we have to define are the load factors and the equations of the Eurocode and what we have to use in the finite element analysis. So here you see table A.24 of the Eurocode of a set B or structural design. And here you see equation 610. And here it is for 610A and 610B. You see the differences between A and B is this C factor in the permanent load. And here you see all these factors for unfavorable and favorable for the permanent loads, And here you see it for the variable loads, dominant or not. And here you see the other difference between A and B is the representativity factor. So how it turns out in Diana and how you have to input them in Diana is that is the last tab of the normative loading dialog box. You have to create a combination of envelope. So in this case, I want to calculate and use both equation A and B. So per equation, you have to specify one combination of envelope. So here you see the values of the load parameter, load factors for 16A. In 16A, you have to apply the representativity factor. So that's why this option, apply representativity factor dominant, is on. And then the factors and these values are depending on the consonant classes and on your annex. You have to fill them in over here for the permanent load, the variable, and for the unvariable, for the permanent load over here, and for the variable loads, you have the traffic loads over here. And you can see the differences between A and B is 1.5. It is without the Xi factor, and here it is with the Xi factor in B. So this unfavorable factor is becoming lower. The last step is to define the results that you want to see, because in Diana, everything, all the load combinations and envelopes are automatically created. But you want to know what is the location of the tandem system that causes these extreme values. Which UDL should be active? Should it be on span 1 or span 2? And this is what you have to select then in the output block of the design. And that is all normative load-related output. And these results, the location of the tandem system, the location of the UDL, and for the variable loads, are all external forces. So that will be nodal results. So here you see an example. And you can see that is all the locations are given for the maximum value of the shear force, but also the maximum and minimum reinforcement moments in X and Y. And even for more directions if you want to average it. But this I will explain later on this presentation. So here you see nicely a top view of a bridge deck, and you can see that the tandem system, the largest, the TS1 should be located over here, 2 over here, and 3 over here. Then you have your extreme, your adverse location to get your extreme values for your moments or shear forces, whatever you select. The same holds if you select the FAZ, the external forces for the UDL, and then you can see which lane is heaviest lane and which loads and which span is loaded. That was all about the traffic load. So now I'm going to talk about a new design feature tools. And the first one that I'm talking about is shifting of the moments. And in the Eurocode, it is described that the shear forces and the longitudinal reinforcements of the moment should be shifted over a distance d. So it is in default the 0.9 multiplied by the thickness of the plate. So we can do that also in Diana. And what you have to do is then you have to use in the analysis setup at shift moments. The length of this line is this ZR multiplied by the thickness, and default what I just said was the 0.9 multiplied with the height. For the X components, the line should be always oriented in the X direction. So X results should be shifted in X directions and Y results should be shifted in Y directions. And due to the shifting, you get two results in one location. And that is why we in Diana get two results, a maximum result with the label a plus sign and a min result with a minus sign to get the shift in the minimum part. And the S label is added to the results that you know that you have used the shifted options. Another feature in Diana, the second one is the averaging. You do not have to design your construction on peak values. Eurocodes allow to average results for the moments and the shear forces. And in Diana, the average is done in a specified direction. So you have to specify the direction, and the direction should be always perpendicular to the results. So the shear force Q X, or in the X direction, should be averaged in Y direction. And it is possible to set a length, different lengths for the reinforcements, for the shear forces and for the bending moments. I can show you in how it turns out in Diana. So how to activate it? We had to add in the design analysis, add average reinforcement moments. And then it automatically fills in the property box that the default is that you have two times the thickness as a length over which the bending moments will be averaged and four times the thickness of the plate for the shear forces. You can define multiple directions for spreading. So in this case, you only have to specify always the directions for X results. So X results, for example, an MXX will be always perpendicular. So will be averaged in direction number two. Direction number two is your Y direction. So perpendicular to the X results. But I also specify another direction, in this case four. This is very important when you have skew plates. You want to average not in Y direction, but along parallel to the support lines. So this is, in this case, direction number four. So then you get the results in multiple average direction. And this label is also given in your result three. The last item for design that I want to explain are the capacities and the unity checks. So capacity are labeled with the RD, so the resistance design, and positive moments, MRD XX plus, for example, results in tension at the positive side. So in this case, the positive Z side. So it gets tension at the top, and if you have an MRD XX minus, you have tension at the bottom. So here you see all the capacity in for the bending moments, but we also have the capacity calculation for the shear forces. The calculation of the capacity can be based on the Eurocodes. So then it's using a bilinear stress strain curve. So the calculation is then based that the concrete can only deal with the compression and no tension. And Diana calculates then the capacity, the bending moment capacity with 3.5 per mil compression strain at extreme fiber. And then use the iterative method with changing the pressure height to get equilibrium. So finally, you get the unity checks in Diana. And for the unity checks in Diana, he divides the extreme moments and shear forces. And these are results out of the normative loading, out of all the automatic generation of load combinations and envelope, you get the extreme moments and shear forces. And if you divide them by the capacity, you get your unity checks. And these are all both, again, available for the shear forces and for your moments. And if, because it are unity checks, if it's small, the values are smaller than one, then the construction is well designed and the construction can resist the load. So now I will go and show you a model that I have created in Diana of a bridge. And this is a 3D model and it's a skewed plate with two span bridge, but even varying the height of the plate. And the carriageway width is 10 meters. So we have three lanes on the bridge. In this model, I analyze only the situation that all the lanes are positioned at the right side of the bridge. So at the bottom side. So here is lane number one, very close to the edge, to the edge load. And this is location of lane number two. And this is location of lane number three. So we only have to define the three lines in the center of these lanes where this tandem system can move over this line, along this line. We divide the UDL in two parts to make it even more simple. And we say everywhere we have a UDL of the 2.5 kilometers per square meters. And only when the tandem system is with the heaviest tandem system number one, with the 300 kilonewton, you have an extra added heavy part of the 6.5 kilonewtons per square meter to get to this 9 kilonewton per square meter in total for this lane number with its very heavy tandem system. You can also do it for every lane separately, but then you need more load cases. It can be done, but it is more work and the differences will be probably very minimal and it will not change the workflow of showing how to do it. So now I will go to the model. So here you see the model, the 3D model. And I first show the geometry. It's all 3D. But the most important thing that you have to know is because it's a 3D model, we have to model composed surface elements and in Diana. And these composed surface elements, we model them to automatically integrate the stresses over the thickness to get the distributed moments and forces like we have in the shell elements. In this case, we just extracted the top surface to become the composed surface. So this, in this case, this composed surface is at the top. But it doesn't matter where you define this composed surface, at the top or at the bottom or even in the neutral middle. Diana will automatically calculate the moments in the neutral plane of all the elements found within the thickness belonging to this composed surface. So if you say and define twice a thickness, he will find all the elements belonging and then automatically calculate it in the neutral middle. If you don't specify any thickness at all, he will go until infinity thickness and find all the elements. In this model, we have a reinforcement at the bottom and a reinforcement at the top. And that is following exactly the shape of the thickness of the plate. And you can see here that we have add extra geometry and that we are going to use for the loading. And these are just separate surface that we didn't imprint, but we use a collateral force to apply on these loads. And for the tandem system, we have to define the three lanes, the center of the three lanes for the tandem system to move over this path. So if I go to the loads, so I have the three tandem system and I defined that is a mobile load. It is related to the whole bridge, but we defined just the path. So in this case, your tandem on lane number three, that is this line. And we say it has two axle forces with a kind of unit 1 kilonewton, and that we can use it with a multiplication factor of 1, 2, or 3 to get a 100, 200, and 300. A wheel print in the Eurocode that is given 0.4 as a square for wheel print. But due to the spreading over the asphalt thickness, it's becoming a little bit larger. The force is in Z direction, and we say that we want a load case every 1 meter along this line. So we have three tandem system mobile loads, and we defined all these UDL load cases with a collateral force. So here, for example, this is lane number one in span one for the lane with the heaviest UDL. And you can see now that it is defined as a total force that will be spreaded over this selected surface. So you have to define these separate load cases that automatically Diana will generate all the load combinations and envelopes out of it. But the separate load cases you have to define yourself. So if we go to the analysis setup, we added the average reinforcements, shear forces and moments. And we say, okay, this is a skewed plate. If I look to the top, that the moments will be average 2 times the thickness, and for the shear 4 times, and we want to average it in for the X results in Y, but also along the support line in number 4. We also want to shift the moments, and we used normative loading to do all the load combinations, envelopes, and so on. So here we have the loads. So here you have the list of all the load cases that we have defined. And in this case, we only have permanent loads. So we set the dead weight to permanent, the asphalt load to permanent, and the edge load to permanent. The other ones, all these load cases we set on not used because we want to use it at the traffic set. So we go to the traffic set and we just create one and say which load case is active in this traffic set. So in this case, then lane number one has a tandem system in lane one with 300 kilonewton because it's using the load factor of 3, and lane number two, 200. And lane number 300. You can just create one, right click and add copy, and then you can just easily duplicate it and change the values from 1 to 3 to, for example, 3 to 1, and then you already have your another traffic set. And the last one in the normative flow that we need is, in this case, I want to check it on 16A and 16B. In 16A, we have to apply the reciprocity factors. And here you have the factors defined out of this annex, what was needed for this construction. And again, if you created just one, you can also duplicate it and copy it to the other one and change the values. And then you have another equation that can be used. So the only thing then is to press the button run and you get your results. I already did that because it took a couple of minutes to run it. But after you run it, you see over here in the messages box that you get an overview of all the results of all the unit checks per span. So per composed element group for composed two, for composed one, for the moments, the unity checks, for the total model, for 16A, for 16B, for the shear forces. So an whole summary of unity checks and extreme values for the equations that you choose to run the calculation for. You can also see in this messages, and all these messages are also logged in the output file, so you can also check them over there. You can also see for all these results what are the load that should be active to get the extreme, for example, shear force in y direction, or to get the extreme reinforcement moment xx plus moment. But you can also see what is, for example, the location of your tendon system, and if the UDL is in the span, yes or no. But as explained in the PowerPoint, you can also view the location of the tendon system and the location of the UDL. But it is also given here, it is for the tendon system. So to get the extreme reinforcement moment in y direction, you have to put the tendon system lane one, that should be the 200 kilonewtons, and it should be positioned, load position number 19, so 18 meters from the beginning. So here you already know where the tendon system should be placed, so you can use this load case to, for example, to continue with a nonlinear calculation. But you can also view them, so that's why we also go to the results. If you have the model data, in the model data, there you can view the capacities. So here, for example, you see the capacities in the top view, and these are the capacities in X, and they are averaged in direction number two, so in Y direction. And you can see locally close to the support lines, you get some distortion of the results. So if you view that locally and look to the results that are averaged parallel to the support lines, you get nice straight lines of your results. And they are, of course, changing because of the thickness of your plate is changing. So you, everywhere in your construction, you have different capacities. So here are the thick beams. So you have a higher capacity than in the middle of the span where you have a less thickness of the plate. The same holds for the capacities for the shear forces. You can also see that you have the results in both average directions in 2 and in Y. So all the independent results are in the model data. These are the capacities. So if you put on the arrow, you go to the combination of envelope, the first one that you have selected. So the first one in our case was the 16A. And I selected just the shear forces and the reinforcement moments and the both unity checks. So I'm interested in the unity checks for the bending moments, for example, and you can plot them. And now I go back to the top view again and see that the maximum values are below one. And this is for X, but also for a positive moment, of course, they are big values at the middle, but there's the support. This is one span, two span. So here you have the positive moments, reinforcement moments. So if you want to have a look at the negative one, they occur in the middle of the spans. But again, you see that the values are much lower than one. So the unity check for the bending moments are okay. You can do the same for the checks on the shear force. So here you see the unity check of the shear force in X direction, and you also have it in Y direction, and also in two direction of averaging. So with all these checks of unity checks smaller than one, you can see that this bridge is well designed. But I also want to show you the nodal results. And in the nodal results, you have these location of your tandem system that causes these extreme values. And these are nodal results. So if I click on that, you don't see anything because I want to see not on the composed elements anymore. So I hide the composed and I want to see the external forces on the solid elements. And because in my case, the composed was on top, I will hide it. And then you see the location of your tandem system. And as I showed you before, you have this location for a maximum shear force in X, in Y, and also for the reinforcement moments in X and Y in all the directions. So this is just for a shear force. If you go for a location of your tandem system for a positive reinforcement moment, then you have to put the tandem system over here. You see that this is the one with the heaviest values, so the largest external force. So this is tandem number one, this is two, and this is three. So then you can check it. And you can also check this UDL. So you can see now for this case, the reinforcement moment, you have to apply the UDL on both spans to get the extreme reinforcement moment in this construction. This was my presentation on the model and about the traffic loads and how we deal with this in Diana.
So once again, I would like to thank you all for attending this session and wish you a great day. Thank you.